Hi, everybody. Let's begin today with prayer. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Lord, teach me to be generous. Teach me to serve you as you deserve, to give and not to count the cost, to fight and not to heed the wounds, to toil and not to seek for rest, to labor and not to ask for reward, save that of knowing that I'm doing your will. Amen. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Well, everybody, we're on to a new chapter, chapter 4. The church is Catholic, the third mark of the Catholic Church. Today, we're going to do it a little bit different. I have a PowerPoint for you, and I hope that is going to be helpful for you as we go through this material. So, let's begin. So, the church is Catholic, and she has this mark of universality. But first, what does Catholic mean? Well, we're going to look at the etymology. The etymology is the study of the history of a word. That's what etymology means. And so Catholic comes from the Greek kata, which means in respect of, and holos, which means whole. So in respect to the whole or universal is katholikos. And then eventually it transferred into the Latin as catholicus. And then now we understand it in English as Catholic. Which means universal or all-embracing. Now, there's an important distinction between the little c and the big C, and your textbook does a great job of talking about this. The church is Catholic as a whole, the big C, and that she's an institution, right? She's an institution with a proper name, right? We capitalize proper names. In a similar way, we capitalize the Catholic Church, which refers to the visible structure and institution of the church, right? So the bishops that we have around us, the priests, the entire community of people that gather together at Mass, as well as all of the different branches and institutions, religious communities around us, all of that makes up the Catholic Church as an institution. And that doesn't just include the tangible organizations that we can see, but also the tangible things that we receive, i.e. the seven sacraments, as well as the doctrines of the church. Little C Catholic refers to the place where we get all of our information. We receive the fullness of truth through revelation itself. That is, through the person of Jesus, who is the fulfillment of revelation in our lives. And what does this revelation come to us through specifically? Well, first, it comes to us through sacred scripture. But this sacred scripture was composed by a group of people, right? The first church didn't have a Bible. Very important to remember. So if we're trying to be like the early church, and we believe that the early church was a part of the church that exists today, then we would not be restricted to thinking that the Bible is required for there to be a church. So we also believe that revelation came to us through the teachings of Jesus, passed down through the teaching of the apostles and the witness of Christians throughout all times and places. So that means that the same revelation that we receive today doesn't just come to us from a state and time 2,000 years ago, rather is continuously revealed to us through the lives of these great people who are real marks of our faith. And we've talked about some of them throughout this year. The first person that ever described, The first person that ever described that the church is Catholic was St. Ignatius of Antioch, who was a bishop of the early church over, yes, you guessed it, the city of Antioch. Now, he was a disciple of St. John the Apostle, the same St. John who is reported to have written the Gospel of John. Okay, so that's very important to know. Whether St. John the Evangelist himself wrote the Gospel or rather passed the tradition down to people who then recorded it isn't important, but we know that he's the source of the material for the Gospel of John. St. Ignatius of Antioch had a personal relationship with Jesus. And I don't simply mean had a personal relationship with Jesus like you and I have a personal relationship with Jesus. I mean, he actually knew Jesus. Tradition says that St. Ignatius of Antioch was actually one of the children who Jesus placed on his lap whenever he told all of the little children that they could come to him. Right, so very important person who traces his faith back in our Lord to his earliest days as a person. Now, towards the end of his life, he wrote significantly these very, very important letters to different churches while he was on his way to Rome to be martyred. And here I have a picture of him at the games being martyred. One of the important things that he talks about which actually helps us to understand the structure of the church, is the importance of bishops. So he writes extensively about the bishops in these 12 letters that he sends, but also what's important is that he's the first person to ever use the term Catholic. Now, why does he use that term? Well, he's trying to emphasize that all of the Christian communities that are throughout the world at this time are united together in the same faith under the same one person, the same head of the church, Jesus Christ. And that the bishops are the ones that actually help to bring about the hands and feet of Jesus in the world today, as he is obviously ascended. What's also important to know is that Catholicism belongs to everybody. And what does that mean? It means that everyone is welcome to join the faith, to repent of their sins, to be baptized, and to be conformed into this one community. The first time that the entire church gathered together with bishops from every continent was actually in the 1960s during Vatican Council II. And there are several people that remark on how amazing it was to finally experience the universality of the church, that all of these people from all of these different places were coming together with the same core faith to profess, to talk about, and to seek to bring a breath of fresh air into. So I find that that is particularly beautiful. Another example of a time when the entire church gathers together is this image of one of the Easter masses right outside of St. Peter's Basilica, where pilgrims from all around the world come together. What is Catholicism, or who does Catholicism also belong to? Well, it belongs to all of creation. We could easily say that the church was made for the world, which is to say that that the church is an institution that exists within the confines of this earth, right, and seeks to do ministry, Jesus's ministry on it. But it would also be proper to say that the world was made for the church. What do I mean by that? Well, I'm not only trying to say that all people, that the Catholic Church desires that all people might be a part of her, but also that what does Catholic, what does church mean? It means that all people desire and ought desire to be in total unity with one another. We see all of these wonderful commercials from groups like Apple and Google that talk about unity in the family or unity amongst different groups of people, right? That inherent human desire that we all have to be one together is the same desire that Jesus had in the deepest part of his own heart, that we might all be one as our Heavenly Father is one. This includes all peoples throughout all time and throughout all areas of the world, but it also includes all of creation. What is the extent of Christ's redemption? Well, he says in Revelation 21, verse 5, that he comes to make all things new. Now, what is that restricted to? Well, nothing. That is restricted to nothing. He comes to make all of creation new, which includes human beings, but is not restricted to human beings, right? We believe that Jesus is going to make this new Jerusalem, which John the Evangelist records in the book of Revelation, this new heaven, which we can kind of understand from our experience on earth, but is perfect in a way that we could have never experienced on earth. And this heaven embodies and takes into it all things that have been created. Now, am I saying that that means that all animals that are on earth go to heaven? I'm not sure. Pope Francis also is not sure. So I can't give you a descript answer on that one. What I can say is that if we look at an understanding of the scriptures, whenever Jesus is talking about all things, we can think that his love isn't restricted to whether you're a human person or not. Okay, so I hope that that gives you some sense of consolation for your lives. And for your understanding of how creation and heaven works. So anyway, that's all that I have for today. What I want you to do is I want you to read all of chapter 4 for the end of this week and then do a short write-up that I'll post for you later on your reading for this week. But again, these are the key things that you should understand. Now, the church to be Catholic means that she's universal, and this universality isn't restricted to time or space, right? All peoples throughout all times are welcome to be a part of this one church, to be a part of this one faith in Jesus Christ. And with that, that's all I have for you today. I hope that you have a wonderful rest of your day, everybody. Take care.